I suppose every era has its uniqueness, but we're going to begin by thinking about Esther, who really was an exile in Persia, and how we're exiles in this world. And so, of course, her famous line is, you know, she's challenged, perhaps you're born for such a time as this, and she says, if I die, I die. And so, had to come to grips with how to live as an exile in her time. So, Psalm 31 says this, but I trust in you, Lord. I say, you are my God. The course of my life is in your power. Your version may say, my times are in your hands. My days are in your hands. Deliver me from the power of my enemies and from my persecutors. Show your favor to your servant. Save me by your faithful love. Lord, do not let me be disgraced when I call on you. Let the wicked be disgraced. Let them be silent in Sheol. Let lying lips be quieted. They speak arrogantly against the righteous with pride and contempt. How great is your goodness that you have stored up for those who fear you and accomplished in the sight of everyone. May the Lord be praised, for he has wonderfully shown his faithful love to me in a city under siege. So David had a weird time. He was living in a city that was under siege. I mean, we all have our different unique times. And so how do we live in such a time as this? How do we live as exiles in a world that looks so much different than the kingdom of God? So let's ask the Lord to help us. Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you so much for your word. And we want to read it and learn from it. Learn from Esther. Lord, we want to sing. We look at the world and we see the chaos and the challenges and the stress. And Lord, it'd be easy, I suppose, to stop singing, but not us. We have something to sing about. We have Jesus who came and died on the cross and conquered sin and death. And he reigns victoriously, advocating for us every day. We have an incredible amount of things to sing about. So may we sing about Jesus, and we pray that our words, our hearts are pleasing to you today. Lord, we pray for those who are watching on YouTube. I think my wife and mother-in-law are watching right now, and many others. And I pray right now, Lord, that you bless them as well. And we give this service to you in Jesus' name. Amen. So, stand and join Scott in worship.
Good morning. God will reign forever, and all the world will know his name. Everyone together, sing the song of the redeemed. Come on! I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. The King has come from heaven, and darkness trembles at his name. Victory forever is the song of the redeemed. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way, my Savior lives. All right, let's all lift our voices this morning and sing, My Savior Lives. All right, sing it out. Here we go.
My Savior lives, my Savior lives, my Savior lives. My Savior lives, my Savior lives, my Savior lives. And I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. Jesus, friend of sinners, we have strayed so far away. We cut down people in your name, but the sword was never ours to swing. Jesus, friend of sinners, truth's become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around but never looking up, so double-minded. A plank-eyed saint with dirty hands and a heart divided. Whoa, whoa, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. Yeah, yeah. Jesus, friend of sinners, the one who's riding in the sand, made the righteous turn away and the stones fall from their hands. Help us to remember we are all the least of these. Let the memory of your mercy bring your people to their knees. Come on, nobody knows. Nobody knows what we're for, only what we're against when we judge the wounded. What if we put down our signs, crossed over the lines, and loved like you did? Whoa, whoa, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. You love every lost cause. You reach for the outcast, for the leper and the lame. They're the reason that you came, Lord. I was that lost cause, and I was the outcast, but you died for sinners just like me, grateful leper at your feet. 'Cause You are good. You are good. And your love endures forever. You are good. You are good. You are good. And your love endures forever. You are good. You are good. You are good. And your love endures forever. Oh, oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. And I was the lost cause, and I was the outcast. You died for sinners just like me, a grateful leper at your feet. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom, be thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, and I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I
riches I heed not.
Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only be first in my heart. High King, my treasure thou art. High King of heaven, when victory is won, may I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's Son. Heart of my own heart, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for this morning. We thank you for everyone here, both in our sanctuary and watching online this morning. We just thank you for each individual, each family represented, and we just pray a special blessing over each of them. We pray for safety, for healing, for just good health. We pray that you would just allow us this morning to just put all of the thoughts in our heads aside for a moment and just focus on you. We pray that we would be able to just focus on your word, learn as we open the book of Esther, and just pour into that and dive into that. Pray that you be with Pastor Mike this morning as he brings your word, and just that you continue to keep us all safe and healthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you for singing, for worshiping. Thank you for joining us. I snuck in the office. There are 13 people watching live, and 13 families, and typically 25 to 30 will watch it in a week's time, so it does provide a service for some who can't be here. Turning your Bibles to the book of Esther, and you might want to put a bookmark there because we're going to be in Esther for 10 or 11 weeks. I think you're going to love the story that unfolds. Esther's a unique book. One of the things about Esther that's really unique is the name of God is not mentioned anywhere in the book. There's no mention of God, and yet he is everywhere in the book of Esther. Sometimes you wonder if God's ever mentioned today, but he's everywhere, and he's still in control. Here's our main characters. Ahasuerus, by the way, I spend way too much time trying to figure out how to say names. And Esther has more crazy names than about any book without a, you know, genealogy than I can remember. So we're going to study how to say that. I watched one video of about 8 pastors saying Ahasuerus, and they all said it different. I'm like, okay, these are big dogs who say things differently. So with humility, we'll try to pronounce these words. Ahasuerus, he is the great Persian king. We're going to meet him today. He's also known as Xerxes. I think I'll go with that. Vashti, or Vashti, is Ahasuerus's queen, who will be in our text this week and next before she is deposed. Haman is that evil official of the court of the king who has a deep hatred for the Jews, and we'll find out about that more later. Mordecai is a Jewish man who is living in Persia and who adopted his cousin Hadassah. You know her as Esther. Esther, of course, is that beautiful Jewish woman who rises to a place of influence and will have to exercise courage to save her people. So why preach through Esther? Well, I wrote down 3 reasons. I'm sure there's 100 reasons. Number one is in the Bible. These are the 3 reasons why I chose Esther. We're preaching through Esther because God's presence and power are everywhere in the book. Chuck Swindoll writes, though God may be at times distant, seem distant, though he is invisible to us, he's always invincible. Though absent by name from the pages of this particular book of Jewish history, God is present in every scene and in the movement of every event until he ultimately and finally brings everything to a marvelous climax as he proves he's Lord of Lords. So God is sovereignly moving the chess pieces behind the scenes. Number 2, we are preaching through Esther not to see Mordecai and Esther as role models. Don't get upset at me. If you read the book carefully, you'll discover quickly that Mordecai and Esther aren't perfect people. We're not here to point that out. But typically, we want to see them as great examples to follow. And Esther, at one point, does exercise courage and save her people, and we can emulate that and should emulate that. We preach Esther because God is the main character of the story. Landon Dowden writes, through his providence and in keeping with his promises, God places Esther and Mordecai in positions of power to preserve his people and punish his enemies. And so God is the one who moves the pieces, and he moves us today. Sometimes we don't even know it, but he's behind the scenes. He's got sovereignty in this world. Number three, we're preaching through Esther to see the great lengths that God goes to preserve his people to keep his promise of a Messiah. So I believe that every book is about Jesus. Well, Jesus actually said that in Luke 24 on the road to what's the road? Thank you. I almost said the Damascus Road, and I thought, that's not right. The road to Emmaus. And so Jesus said everything in Scripture from the book of Moses, the Psalms, the history is about Jesus. So how is Esther about Jesus? Again, Dowden writes, in redemptive history, the book of Esther is not only about God's continuing to have a people, but also about his preservation, that his people don't go extinct. Somewhere in Ahasuerus' realm were those through whom the Messiah would eventually be sent, and nothing Haman or Satan could overcome God's protective hand in bringing forth the Messiah through his people. So as you think about how God works to preserve his people, to bring forth the Messiah, remember, God keeps his promises. Now, the Jewish people were taken into captivity by the Babylonians for 70 years. The Babylonians were defeated by the Persians. And Xerxes is the grandson of Cyrus, who defeated the Babylonians and let the Jews go back to Jerusalem. He's also the son of Darius, who let the Jews go back to build the temple, rebuild the temple. For whatever reason, we still have Jews living in Persia. They're exiles. And I want you and I to think today that about us being exiles in this world. And every day I feel more like an exile. But that's what Peter said in 1 Peter 2, 11 and 12. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. So Peter says, we're traveling through this world. We're sojourners. We're exiles. We don't belong here. Jesus put it this way, to his disciples, you are to be in the world, but not of the world. We're exiles. So how do exiles live honorably in a world gone mad? By the way, that's one of my I'm reading four commentaries, whatever. One of them is how to be faithful in a world gone mad. That's Esther, being faithful in a world gone mad. Well, first, exiles live honorably among the world's glory. Look at verse 1. Now in the days of Ahasuerus, or Xerxes, if you please, the Xerxes who reigned from India to Ethiopia over 127 provinces, in those days when King Xerxes sat on his royal throne in Susa, the citadel, in the third year of his reign, he gave a feast for all his officials and servants. The army of Persia and Media and the nobles and governors of provinces were before him, while he showed the riches of his royal glory and the splendor and pomp of his greatness for many days, 180 days. Now, somebody help me real quick and do the math. How many months is that? Let's see, 180 days. Six, very good. How many years is that? That's like a half a year. So we're going to see that there's a feast that goes on for 6 months, displaying the glory, the pomp, and circumstances of the greatness of Xerxes. So we want to set the setting of Esther, the world that Esther lived in. Just get a glimpse of the culture in which the exiles lived. We are told that Xerxes was the king during Esther's time. He was the grandson of, I said earlier, of Cyrus, the first Persian king, the son of Darius, the second Persian king. Don't miss the breadth of his power and glory. We're told that he reigned over 127 provinces from India to Ethiopia. If you look at a modern map, which I did this week, you will see that he ruled over Western India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Iran, Iraq, Armenia, Syria, Lebanon, Israel, Jordan, Turkey, Northern Greece, Egypt, Libya, Eritrea, Ethiopia, and Northern Sudan. If you get on the map, it's impressive. He really ruled over all the known world except part of Greece, which he attacked several times and got defeated. Our story opens with King Xerxes on his royal throne in the citadel, a fortress, the fortress of Susa, throwing a six-month drunken feast for all his officials and servants with his great army present. What was the purpose of the feast? Well, many speculate that he was prepping his army for another invasion of Greece, and so he's trying to grease the wheels. Would have been a great time for a foreign army to invade them, is all I'm saying. But we're told in our text why he did it. He was displaying the riches of his royal glory and the splendor and pomp of his greatness. Really, 180 days of his greatness being displayed, his glory being displayed. What arrogance. Mike Cosper writes, no matter how you frame it, the party itself was a terrifying place. Now you think of a party being a fun place. He argues it was a terrifying place. The king wielded near absolute power in his kingdom. He gave life and he took it. He conscripted Susa's sons into his army and his daughters into his harem. Criminals and offenders on the crown were regularly impaled on stakes and hoisted high in the air, their twisted bodies a warning to anyone who thought to violate the law or fall into disfavor. His name was revered, his decrees terrified. The citadel loomed over the city. A god lived there, little g if you please. A god lived there, and he sat on his high throne, surrounded by slaves and servants and 1,000 works of art that celebrated him and his divinity. And improbably, he invited them into his palace and threw a feast. A terrifying feast. This is the world in which Esther lived. The world wants glory. Every once in a while, we want just a little recognition, don't we? We want a little glory. We want folks to notice how great we are. But that's the way of the world. That's human nature. So what do we need to remember as exiles? And I turn to Isaiah 40, verse 21 through 24. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundation of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain, spreads them like a tent to dwell in, and brings princes to nothing, and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. So as we live in this world, maybe we need to be reminded today that Xerxes is but a grasshopper. Now, all those who didn't know the Lord would be terrified in the presence of a despot. But we're going to find out there's one brave woman and a brave cousin. But from God's perspective, all the rulers of this world are nothing compared to God. And as exiles, we need to worry about giving him glory and not the rulers of this world. And by the way, I'm not getting into politics or anything like that. The ultimate ruler of this world is Satan and his dominions. And we never want to give him glory. When we give self glory, or even others in position of power that they might give us glory, we're diminishing the glory we need to give to the Lord. We must live honorably among the world's glory. Second, we must live honorably among the world's riches. Look at verse 5. And when these days were completed, okay, when the 6 months were done, okay, we've had 6 months, just kind of mention it briefly, of revelry. When the days were completed, the king gave for all the people present in Susa the citadel, both great and small, a feast lasting for 7 days in the court of the garden of the king's palace. We're not done partying. There were white cotton curtains and violet hangings fastened with cords of fine linen and purple to silver rods and marble pillars, and also couches of gold. How do you watch a 2-hour movie on a couch of gold? I'm just, I don't know. Sometimes you want to know. Couches of gold and silver and a mosaic pavement of marble, mother of pearl, precious stones. Drinks were served in golden vessels, vessels of different kinds, and the royal wine was lavished according to the bounty of the king. So after 6 months of feasting and drunkenness, they have another week. He hasn't had enough. So this is for a feast of those who are living in Susa, both the great and small. But no one seems to be tired of partying, and the king's glory was still on display. Listen to his riches. I know it's hard for us to understand what some of these things are, but cotton curtains, violet hangings, marble pillars. We're told from other sources that there were 36 pillars, 70 feet high. They were glorious, apparently. There were couches of gold and silver, a mosaic pavement. We believe had feldspar, crystals, marble, mother of pearl, precious stones, all in the pavement. Drinks were served in golden vessels. You come to my house, you get solo cups. No one thought that was funny. Okay. Drinks were served in golden vessels. The wine was lavishly poured out according to the bounty of the king. What a gracious guy, this King Xerxes. What a gracious guy. What an unbelievable, excessive display of riches and feasting. This is what Mike Cosper writes. Here's how rich Xerxes was. A few years later, when the Greek war ended in failure for Persia, the Persians retreated and the Greeks overtook their encampment. Herodias wrote that the Greeks found gold and silver couches left behind. They took gold and silver couches to war? No wonder they lost. Not coins, not statues, golden and silver couches. Persia was a kingdom full of idols, and no greater display of their idolatry was during this time of worshiping riches and the glory of the king. The riches are ridiculous and obnoxious. They were obtained by plunder. They were intoxicated with their idolatry. Xerxes was drunk on wine, drunk on his own glory, and drunk with his own riches. Surely this was the good life in Persia. Christopher Ashe writes, the description here is meant to be jaw-dropping in its sense of wonder. There is nothing in biblical literature to rival it except the tabernacle and Solomon's temple. We are meant to bow in a kind of worship at the visible wonder of this empire of the world. For this is the awe of a religious experience. As you read it, be there in your mind's eye, looking round with wide-eyed, popping wonder. Wow. The riches of the world. And you've been invited to a feast. So this was the world that Esther lived in. What about us? What should be our response? How do we live honorably in a world that holds out the idol of riches? Well, 1 Timothy 6:10 says, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil." So greed is the root of many other evils. Now you all have heard me preach enough, and you know your Bible well enough. There's nothing inherently wrong with money. In fact, there are places we're told to work, support your family, save, and give. Okay? So that's a whole nother sermon. Dave Black could give that to you in 5 minutes in the foyer if you want it. So it's the love of money and the riches. By the way, we just a couple weeks ago preached on the rich young ruler. Or was that last week? I think it might have been last week. And he walked away because of his love for riches. 1 John 2:15 through 17 says, "Do not love the world or the things in this world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and the pride of life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires. But whoever does the will of God abides forever." So what we see with our eyes and we kind of lust after, it passes away. But we trade all that for the riches of heaven that does not fade away. We must live honorably among the world's glory, among the world's riches. And lastly, we must live honorably among the world's power. Look at verse 8 and 9. "And the drinking was according to this edict. There is no compulsion, for the king had given orders to all the staff of his palace to do as each man desired. Queen Vashti also gave a feast for the women in the palace that belonged to King Xerxes." Okay, there's a lot in there. I wanted to tell you something I didn't know. Martin Luther didn't like the book of Esther. We know we had a trouble with the book of James, right? Some of you know that. He didn't like Esther. He thought it was too scandalous. It had too many heathen unnaturalities, he wrote. And as you see as we walk through the book, it's hardly a PG-rated book if you really, really understand what's happening. One commentator said that the book of Esther is more like the Game of Thrones than VeggieTales. Which, thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Kinsey. So, you know, parents, we'll keep this PG. But if you read this out loud with your kids, just know there's a lot of violence, a lot of sex, and every kind of excess that culture has to offer. And Martin Luther said, there's too much heathen unnaturalities in this book. And here the feast becomes a drunken party. The king is so drunk with power that he makes an edict on drinking. Now, what I want us to see, I mean, this is a good time to say, do not get drunk on wine that leads to debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. That's Ephesians 5:18. God's word is clearly against drunkenness. So, we'll remind each other of that. But I don't think that's not the point I want to bring out. He actually made an edict on what they could eat and drink. We got to see through the story, he loves edicts. And once he makes an edict, you can't change it. Have you heard of the law of the Medes and Persians? That's a phrase borrowed from Esther in history. Well, when the law of the Medes and Persians were written, you cannot undo it. It is permanent. And I wanted to point out that here's his first edict. Mike Cosper writes, "Normal custom would have required that anything served by the king to his guests must be consumed." Hey, kids, you're in the presence of the king, and he says, "Today you get broccoli." And you say, "I don't like broccoli." Off with your head. Okay, so you eat what the king gives you. You drink what the king gives you. moms and dads, that's probably not something you want to do at home, but off with your head. I'm going to go on. Regardless of the will of the guest, the fullness of the belly, or the level of sobriety, the guests must eat them. Instead, the king made room for people to come and go, to drink and eat as they wished, to enjoy his table without the burdens of decorum. Xerxes presided over the whole thing, at times seated on a throne above the crowd, at times mixing in with the dazzled commoners. It wasn't enough for this king to be feared. He wanted to be adored. And the royal treasury bought innumerable casks of wine, bushels of grain, bleeding heads of sheep and goats, all to pour out on the city like flowers from a lover to a beloved. Entertainers danced and sang and told bawdy jokes day and night. Slaves and prostitutes were put to work. To call it excessive is to put it mildly. One note in the Talmud, which is one of the principal texts of rabbinic teaching, has this note: Satan himself danced that day with King Xerxes. Satan himself was dancing. That's according to the Jewish rabbis. So this is the world in which Esther lived. What about us? Yes, it's a good time to remind us God does not like drunkenness. We have an altar to deal with that. And I'm not making light of that. I have family that struggle with that. What do we do in a live, how do we live in a world honorably that values power? Here we have see a king who has all power. He can even tell them, only eat this. Now, boys and girls, you can eat everything. Thank you. I mean, he had absolute control about what they could do over every detail of their life. And those who don't have power want to grab power. I mean, that's the human nature. That's human history, always grabbing power. What did Jesus say about grabbing power? What did Jesus say about climbing the ladder, stepping over people to get what you want? Well, he was talking to his disciples in Mark 10, verse 42. He says, you know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lorded over them. So here's some rulers. Xerxes was one who lorded it over them. And their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. And whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. So in a world that glorifies power and tries to grab power, encourages you to use your power to get ahead, Jesus says the first will be last. The great will be the least. And you and I will serve. That's how you live honorably as an exile. And we must live honorably among the world's glory. We are told to do that. We must live honorably among the world's riches. We are told to do that. We must live honorably among the world's power. Not imitating the world, but imitating the kingdom and Jesus. So how do you respond to this message this morning? To live as exiles in the world, we have to remember this. This is not our home. This is not where our citizenship is. Yes, we have a U.S. passport, and we go to other nations. Someday, willingly, we go to other nations. I'm longing for that day. But Paul writes in Philippians 3, 20 and 21, our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him to be subject all things to himself. So our citizenship is not here. Peter said we're sojourners, we're exiles. Our citizenship, if you're a believer in Jesus, is in heaven. That's where he's going to subject all the Xerxes, all the kings, all the CEOs, all the people who think they're important are going to be made to kneel and bow and confess that Jesus is Lord. They're but grasshoppers to him. So, do you want to be an Esther? Do you want to live a life honorably as an exile in a world gone mad? Then we live honorably among the world's glory, giving God all the glory due his name. We live honorably among the world's riches, desiring the riches of heaven. We live honorably with the world who vies for power, but we surrender to serve. May we be kingdom people as we live in exiles here on this earth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for Esther. I'm excited about walking through this book and seeing how in your providence you saved your people, and in saving your people, of course, save the conduit for sending the Messiah, Jesus. Every page is about him. Every book reminds us about him, even if he's not named. The lengths you went to save and preserve your people, we're going to find out there was an evil man who wanted to exterminate all the Jews. And you protected them and kept your promise in sending a Messiah through them, Jesus. So, Lord, we are exiles. We don't belong here. We belong in the kingdom of God. And yet you have sent us into the world, but not to be of the world. So help us to live as we're in the world honorably, as the world vies for glory, as the world gets drunk on riches and other excesses, as the world vies for power. It's so sad to see all the folks who are living just the opposite of kingdom living. But God, here, raise up servants. You want to serve. Yes, being stewards of the money you give us, the property and riches you give us, but not going after riches. In fact, we work hard to share with others, to give, to take care of our family. But Lord, all the serving and stewarding, we want it to be for your honor and glory. God, there are times we want to take glory. We might even get upset when someone else seems to take the glory. But God, every time we try to take the glory, it diminishes what we're saying about you. You deserve all honor, glory, and praise. And as I live as an exile in this world, may I remember that all the rulers, all the athletes, me, but a grasshopper to you. We're but a vapor that's here for a brief time. So, Lord, we need to get right with you. If there's anyone here who's never given their life to you through Jesus and his death on the cross, we pray that they might understand that when they do that, they're literally stepping from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. They're stepping out of the kingdom of hate and into the kingdom of love. They're stepping out of the kingdom of power and riches and glory into the kingdom of serving and worship. So God, may we live as kingdom citizens, as exiles in this world, and help us as we sing this last song and respond in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand and respond as the Lord leads you?
Here is love, vast vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood, who his love will not remember, who can cease to sing his praise, he can never be forgotten throughout heaven's eternal day. On the mount of crucifixion, fountains open deep and wide. Through the floodgates of God's mercy, flowed a vast and gracious tide. Grace and love like mighty rivers, poured incessant from justice, kissed a guilty world in love. Who his love? Who his love will not remember? Who can cease to sing his praise? He can never be forgotten throughout heaven's eternal day. Let me all thy love accepting, love thee ever all my days. Let me seek thy kingdom only, and my life be to thy praise. Thou alone shalt be my glory, nothing in the world. Thou hast cleansed and sanctified me. Thou thyself hast set me free.
Thou alone shall be my glory. That is what we need to remember in a world that vies for glory and power and riches. Not us. We vie for God's glory, heaven's riches, and just picking up a towel. Hey, announcements. Pardon the mess. The folks were here yesterday stirring up dust, John. And so we did the best. In fact, some of you remember Caitlin was here filling in for Kaylee yesterday, and Caitlin DePew, and she did a marvelous job getting the bathrooms looking like they do. So I like to think of it as progress, because I'm a half glass, half full kind of guy. You may see a lot of dust. I see progress. So I think we're getting flooring soon, and it's going to look great, so be patient. We're going to give out food again on Wednesday. I am just stunned how many people are stopping me, thanking us for food, and people from all over. So it's been a good ministry of our church. Anything else we need to share? Bullfrogs and Butterflies, 6:30, meet here. And go to a creek. Which creek? Grace wants to know. Okay. All right. I'll bring appropriate clothes next time. YouTube doesn't need to know this. But last time we went to Bullfrogs and Butterflies and we went to the creek, I went like this. And I just was going to watch. Instead, I ended up wading in the creek. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. It's so good to be with our church family. And thank you for those who are watching today. They're still part of our family. And God, now I pray that we will embrace the fact that we are exiles. We're not even attempting to blend in. I mean, we stand out. But we're going to love people, we're going to serve people, we're going to give you glory, and we're going to deny ourselves of the excesses that are offered to us, that we might share with others, that we might focus on the riches of heaven, knowing that that's where our citizenship is. I pray you be with us as we walk through Esther, and we just want it to be a special time. That it'll help us think through how to live in such a time as this. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.